Hello.
And we are Lion and Lion. What's up, Facebook?
My brothers and sisters. Hello, 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 hello. Let's get comfy.
Let's get comfy.
I know. Can you pass me my water, too? Yes. I'm going to have my water. And pass me that as well, too.
Which one?
Pass me that right there.
Can't not have your cup.
Gotta have my power.
I switched out my cups.
I'm magical.
I got rose gold cups.
I knew she was cool when I first met her. We passed each other in an expo. And she walked by me and I saw her cups and everything. She was like, "What's up, brother?" I was like, "What's up, sister?" I was like, "I gotta talk to her." But we knew each other from back in the day. We're gonna get into that.
We're totally gonna get into that.
We knew each other from back in the day when she was on General Hospital and I was on Port Charles back in like 2000 or something like that.
It was such a fun time. It was a fun show.
It was like.
It was an experience.
I didn't go to college.
Neither did I.
I had that experience, like a college dormitory experience there. Because we were in the dress room and everything, right? We would have the long hallways. I mean, we would be bowling balls down the hallway with pins, practical jokes. I remember one time me and my love interest Aaron were trying to like do a love scene
on the show, not for real.
And one of the prop guys ended up, we were in the bathtub, he ended up opening up the door, and he was on the toilet in the bathroom, on the set, playing a practical joke. I mean, it was like total college, like, pranks all the time.
There was very interesting things that happened.
Jimmy's probably here watching it. I still keep
awesome.
With Jimmy. What's up, y'all?
What's up?
So anyways, the relationship, ultimate relationship series. Cheers. Take it, my sis. I'm gonna have something to drink.
What's up, guys? Hey, let's see. I see James. I see Stacy over on you and Diana. I see Jillian. What's up? So it's a little further away tonight. So we're gonna.
What's up, Stace? That's my neighbor, Stace. What's up?
Oh, awesome. What's up, girl?
And Diana, I've known since I was in seventh grade. Crazy. Since we were kids.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So, good evening. We're so excited that you guys have chosen to connect with us this evening. And we've got our notes so we don't miss anything, right?
Because this is like really, it's important.
Yeah.
It's an important topic, you know?
It's a fun topic.
It's fun and it's important because everything is relationships.
Everything is relationships.
Whether it's a relationship with a friend of yours, like me and my sister right here, a relationship with a loved one, a relationship
with money,
your creator, your stuff, whatever.
I like to say how you do one relationship is how you do them all. So, but we're going to talk in this series, right? We wanted to open it up for having the conversation with you guys as well. So getting everybody kind of interactive and sharing some fun tips, sharing the things that we've learned. You know, emotional mastery, actors. We don't know anything about emotion.
Because it's, you probably noticed the world is changing at a rapid pace.
Yeah.
Things are changing.
Yeah.
And we got to be able to adapt and be flexible and ebb and flow and make sure that we're making highly conscious choices that are great for ourselves, but ideally great for everybody.
Yeah. And going with the flow. Kind of like what next level can we constantly, you know, get ourselves to? Yeah. And so, yes, we want to be able to just paint that picture. Do you need to get that? What is that?
No, don't worry about it. Got text messages coming through. Hey,
this is why I love live, because it's just like anything can happen. This is so like, God, this is like improv theater.
Like theater, I was going to say 24-hour play.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Okay, so either way, you know, ultimately, you know, we want to paint the picture for you guys and have you interact with what this kind of bigger picture looks like for particularly tonight. What we're talking about is the dynamic of masculine feminine, right? And what that looks like within a romantic partnership, friendship, and most importantly, then the balance within yourself. So we've got some nifty notes here. And we were just having, we always have this conversation.
Because there's, you want to jump into this?
Oh, yeah. Like.
Who's going to go? You or me?
You go.
Okay. All right. He's like, go, and then you're about to read some notes and everything. I like to just, like, kind of spit it.
We didn't plan anything.
Oh, we plan to do something. Because, you know, there's kind of like, I feel like there's new people that are happening. There's old archetypes, there's new archetypes. Yeah. There's a different dynamic. There's women that are wondering what a man wants. There's a man, you know, wondering what a woman wants. And there's sort of like this big miscommunication. Mm-hmm. And I think as an actor, I've kind of learned to like observe and notice what's happening mm-hmm. with people and with environments.
And embody, too. We embody different characters and embody different emotions.
And what I'm noticing that there's different characters showing up. Exactly. There's
and different archetypes.
That's what I'm saying. As an archetype, as a character, there's different archetypes showing up as a man. So we want to go over like these old archetypes and then these new archetypes. And like
what's
how to
the next archetype?
What's the next archetype and how to bring them together. Yeah. And, you know,
and
it's kind of like a snake that sheds an old skin and becomes this new snake. Mm-hmm. Or a caterpillar that's been a caterpillar forever and then it turns into a butterfly, which is a new archetype. So we're going to go over some cool stuff about that has to do with you and me and everything that in our life.
Yeah, because so. This was a couple months ago, you know, I ended up doing a survey between about 30, I think it was about 30 men and 30 women, roughly, 25, 30. And asking them all the same question, right? About like what it is that they wanted in relationship, how their last ones either worked out or didn't work out, right? And what they liked about it, what they didn't like about it. And ultimately, by the end of it, the really fascinating thing that I found was that both men and women want exactly the same thing, right? Which is like trust, communication, and respect. Those were like roughly like the top three, you know, and like so everybody wants the same thing, and yet in the responses each person who responded was also still afraid of opening up and trusting again, or how do you have then greater communication. And so I just thought that was very interesting, where it's basically both men and women, we want the same things, and yet both men and women haven't found a way to give it to each other.
And you know, there's we're kind of getting into it already. There's a strength that you have to have. There's a strength that you, whether it be a man or a woman, there's a strength that you need to have to be able to, one, communicate, but then also, like, how transparent are you being? Mm. And where are you communicating from? Are you communicating, like, you know, just thoughts from a logical or egotistical side of wanting to be right? This has got to be done this way. Or is there a real, I think
intuitive.
That we've intuitive, heartfelt place that we can come from? And I think that what I've noticed is that a lot of our culture, men in particular, have been disconnected, in a sense, from this space down here. You know, have been taught, conditioned, trained, and convinced and programmed to be these hard, objective, logical, you know, because if you look at the video games, if you look at just, you know, the sports and everything, everything is very, very, nothing's going to lead a man to getting in touch with his emotions. And he doesn't have to be soft. You know, he doesn't have to be hard. A man actually can have, there's the balance of both.
And for women as well.
And for women as well, too. Yeah. A woman, you know, it used to be a bad thing.
The girly factor.
Oh, you throw like a girl.
Yeah.
That used to be a bad thing.
Or you cry like a girl.
Or you cry like a girl. And that used to be a bad thing, but that's a good thing now, because women...
It's a vulnerability, and now I think more people are having the conversation on vulnerability.
Exactly.
More men are having that, and not looking at it as, you know, girly or whatever. But it is feminine, because it's emotional and fluid.
I mean, a man being able to access his emotions is a strength. Mm-hmm. I mean, as an actor...
You have to!
What do you want to watch on somebody on the screen? Do you want to watch an actor who doesn't have access to emotions, or do you want to see an actor that feels something?
There's a couple actors like that.
Yeah, there's a couple, but that's not interesting to me.
No.
You know what I'm saying? Like when we go to watch something on TV, we want to watch somebody have an experience. Sometimes for us,
Well, that's what acting, the root of what acting is reenacting in an authentic way and having to be vulnerable and getting into that place so that then you can show somebody what it looks like, what an experience looks like, and having people connect to that. You know, we're getting off on, well, let's say it's
hi, Sherry. Hi, some people. It's my neighbor. Hi, Donna.
What's up, Stephanie?
Fam.
What's up, Amateo, my brother? So, yes, we're getting into the whole, like, actor conversation, but ultimately, but it's the same thing. It's emotional intelligence. But yeah. And then I think even as a woman, yes, right now, you know, a lot of women, I feel, I'll speak for myself, like, you know, it's really developing that strength, and having the balance of that strength with vulnerability, mm-hmm. but then it's almost like it's the man's world, right, so to speak, but then having to, like, to compete with that and go more into your masculine as a woman, right, which takes us out of this, like, this feminine radiance, this fluidity, yeah. that, you know, way back in the day, like, women were the oracles that, you know, transcribed and channeled in intuitive information for the culture, for the community, right? And that was honored and that was respected. And so the more that women are having to compete in this, like, masculine dominance, we're losing our femininity. We're losing our intuition
yeah.
and our intuitive senses, or I should say it's more difficult. It's becoming more difficult.
It's kind of like you're working against the flow of
who you are. Yes.
You know what I mean? Like, a woman is by nature intuitive.
Right.
By nature, it's like this, a woman, or it's really more feminine and masculine.
Mm-hmm.
And most, because there's some women that are more masculine than they are feminine, and there's some men.
I enjoy my masculine side.
Well, it's all good.
I enjoy my feminine side too.
But, you know, it's like the women, it's a femininity.
Yeah.
It's feminine and masculine. Feminine is creative, it's soft lines,
yes.
it's these,
yes.
it's ebbs
fluid.
And flows, it's fluid,
emotion.
Intuitive, things like that. When you got the masculine, you're talking about very, like, left brain stuff, logical,
mm-hmm.
you know, rigid, straight lines,
mm-hmm.
you know, point A to point B, figuring stuff
mm-hmm.
out, equations,
the
boom,
logistics.
Boom, 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 boom.
The
but
mechanics.
You can't have one or the other. If you just have too much femininity, you'll never get anything, things won't forward how you want to forward. And if you have too much masculinity, you'll move forward, but you'll probably destroy everything in the process.
And
kind of like what's happening on our planet right now.
Right.
I'm sorry. That's what the masculine is doing. Too much masculine will destroy and just penetrate and just destroy.
Well, and not think about the emotions, not think about the creative. You know, it's like you talk about even just as a dynamic. You know, the workaholic. If you're working all the time, right, and that's all masculine, you're not thinking about, like, okay, how do I nurture this, like, the feminine aspect or the relationship aspect or whatever that is.
Look,
so that
and
goes
and
on
how,
global.
I used to be a workaholic myself.
Yeah.
I used to work, and
mm-hmm.
I can still, but now it's like it doesn't even feel right because I've learned how to tap into my feminine side
right.
and how to actually know what I need and
mm-hmm.
when to give myself what I need. Like,
mm-hmm.
when I need to go out on a walk. Like, today,
mm-hmm.
I went to the beach today. I had some time.
I know, it was awesome.
You know what I'm saying? I went to the beach, but I needed that. Like, my soul needed that.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's one side that kind of resists the beach. But then when I get there, I'm like, okay, now I'm in the flow, man.
I
mean, it's magic.
But we get addicted to all these different things. You can get addicted to being a workaholic. You can get addicted to being in the mind and running all, like, all these different stresses. We got some questions and comments.
My man Juan, okay, he says, as a youth, my father.
What's up, Aaron? What's up, Lindsay?
Showcased. Oh, what's up, Andrew? Damn.
We're gonna save a lot of questions for, like, the end too. But
yeah, we are.
There's some. We love your guys' interaction.
Okay,
as
cool,
well.
Cool. I thought I had a question.
Okay.
Yeah, and I grew up like that too, as well. Like being stifled in our emotions, or the man not being able to, not being accepted to
mm.
have emotions without being
That's
looked
such a
at
huge topic.
As weak.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's okay for, it's, I'm not even gonna say it's just okay, it's necessary, I feel, for a man
to create that balance
to understand that's, if he's not expressing his emotions, if he's
mm.
not expressing his fear, his pain,
mm-hmm.
his whatever that is, his tears, everything, that he's not really expressing all of who he is. I mean, there is great power and accepting all of who you are. And accepting
all of then who a woman is as well. Exactly. And honoring and respecting that within both.
Well, a man has to overcome, I can accept myself for having these sensitive emotions. And
so what is that, like self-judgment? Like having self-judgment on, like, you're saying I can accept myself for having these emotions?
Well, yeah.
Like, do you think men, like, judge themselves?
I think we've been taught to judge ourselves.
Totally.
And we've been taught to be these hard-nosed type characters,
right,
that don't have, you know, a certain amount of sensitivity towards us, that we'll go to war in a second, but, you know, we won't really think about what we're doing necessarily. It's kind of like, you know, if you look at, sometimes law enforcement, they jump into action without really being sensitive and aware of what's really happened. It's like, let me just take care of the situation, but then they end up killing somebody.
Right.
Certain things are going too far rampant.
Totally. And if you're so far into the masculine, like, then how, like, connecting with a woman, you connect to a woman through your feminine side. So you have like a strong masculine side, right? Which is what a woman finds attractive. I don't want to take away from that either. Right?
She likes her men.
And at the same time, connecting to, like...
Yes, she does. Focus.
Focus.
Get your point across.
What was I saying? Connecting to the feminine?
You said you like, you want a man to have his...
You don't want him to lose his masculinity.
You
can't lose the masculine side. Don't eat too much tofu, you know? Like, stay on the masculine, like, I got this, right? And at the same time, that's how you connect to the feminine as well, is to getting in touch with your own intuitive side, you know? And the other point, and we had talked about this in a previous conversation, but it was such a solid point, is like for women, I'll say this as a woman, for women, it's creating that safe space for men to show up with their vulnerable side, right? To show up and not judge a man if he's going through like an emotional space. Like, if a man wants to be able to cry and get into that, like, most of society says that a man has to then fight or, you know, go boxing or work out or whatever to release the energy, because emotion is energy in motion, right? And so in order to release that or to transform that, he can't cry, because that's a release of energy either way. So he has to do something that looks manly to release the energy. And yet, as women, what we can do is create a really nurturing space and safe space so that then they can show up.
I mean, I was just telling Serah, a few days ago, I saw a man, a video or something like that, and he ended up crying. And then there was a girl that commented on the video, and she commented, she was like, "Oh, look at him being a little bitch." And I was like, wow. I'm like...
What is it with people online too, by the way?
I don't want to like single her out. It wasn't about that, because it's really about like kind of like the environment that we all created. I mean, the point that I'm trying to make here is that say for example, if you have a guy and they're battling...
It
didn't create a space for him. No. And that was just a comment
right.
and everything.
Right.
But like, if I'm, you know... let's say, because we're at war, and then my buddy dies. Am I not supposed to, you know,
right.
mourn my
right.
brother? Am I not supposed to cry and express
right.
my brother, the loss of my brother? That's not the only...
But that's the thing, is it's like, there's certain acceptable times when that's like, okay, and
then there's not
acceptable.
That's for...
Like,
I know,
I'm
exactly.
Not
that's
saying
exactly.
that, I'm saying
I know.
Yeah.
But I'm saying, forget what society is talking about. I'm talking about
right.
that's for you to decide... when you need to express it. That's what we're talking
right.
about. The man has to be able to, and the woman, know when, kind of like be sensitive enough to see what's going on, and then strong enough, having the courage enough
right.
to like say, you know, I can actually express this.
Right.
And it's good for him to have a safe space, if a woman holds a space, or if a guy holds a space, things like that. It's really powerful when guys can hold that space for one another.
Right.
And because guys can hold a space when we're playing football and we're doing these other things, but can we be strong enough to hold a different space for one another?
Right.
That feminine energy, the balance of the yin and the yang, that's what we're talking about.
Right.
The yin and the yang here. You see what I'm saying? So
well, and if you're going into the yin, which is more
I'm getting
emotional,
hot talking about this. I'm like,
so am I, dude. It's like, it's
woo! Give me blood, my blood pumping up
here. If
you
go into the yin,
I feel something about that, man.
I know.
About this subject.
And if you go into the yin, you want to then also, you go back into the yang anyway. You go back into the masculine. It's like, you know, a 50-50%. But, you know, to be honest, what I get a little heated about as a woman is being able to hold that space for a man, yes, but then it's like just on the flip side, it's like, well, where are men showing up? Some of them. Where are men showing up and supporting then the masculine in the woman and not looking at that as saying like, oh, that's too intimidating, or that's too, like, oh, she's too masculine now, or she's not enough feminine,
or
whatever.
They would say, oh, since you like the feminine, so you voting for Hillary Clinton? No,
right.
You voting for Hillary Clinton? I'm like, she's not feminine. I'm like, she's a woman.
Oh, God.
But she ain't feminine.
You don't know what she does in her house.
Man, I know she got her voices deeper than me, and she's like, listen.
She got those bah, little bah, heels bah, bah. With a little puffy
yeah,
thing.
Yeah, but, I, yeah but my intuition is telling me it ain't like that. My intuition is telling me she don't be getting sexy down like that. That my intuition is telling me. My feminine side is telling me,
You can't see Hillary Clinton on a pole?
I'm about to cut this live. Here we go. Because we're not going to talk about Hillary Clinton on a pole. I'm sorry. I'm sorry for that. I'm sorry for that imagery. If you got like a real visual person.
My point is. You're like, I don't like that. My point
gotta
is.
Be strong.
Is
you
that
gotta
are
be strong.
We holding? Are we holding? Embrace that strong feminine.
What's your point? What's your point?
My point is. Having to hold the space for both.
Yeah.
And creating that space for both. Women really showing up and holding that nurturing side for men without judgment.
Yep.
But then equally so, like, men showing
not
up and holding...
Not
being intimidated by a woman who's like, yo, I want to grow my own business. I want to be out there running it. I want to, like, you know, that penetrative masculine kind of energy.
Look,
I like owning that.
And that doesn't intimidate
and you
me.
And honor that
I do honor that. I love that about
that's
you. Like,
you have a nice balance.
Yeah, exactly. Like... I love being in touch with my feminine. She loves being
yes,
in touch with her
too.
Masculine. So, but like a lot, but we were talking earlier and she was saying how a lot of guys get intimidated about a woman who's strong or a woman who can tap into her masculine. And, you know, I think there's a few things happening when a guy gets intimidated. First of all, I think that the man...
Yes, share. That would be great information.
Well, My opinion, you know, of this off the top of my head, really, would you know, because I think it's different for every case. But a lot of guys who get intimidated by a powerful woman are not really tapped into their true power as a man. They're not really tapped in. They're tapped into a faux power, a fake power, an egotistical power, macho.
Very interesting point.
You see what I'm saying? Because this is like a deeper subject. You know, and the basics of a man and a woman, they actually need each other. A man needs a woman to grow.
Right.
He needs her to actually...
That's an interesting... Can you say that again?
Yeah, I'm going to say it. I'm going to say a little more, too. So don't cut me off. So a man needs a woman to grow spiritually because they have a vested interest. It is exactly yin and yang.
Right.
Those two dynamics don't separate. He needs her to grow because she's going to help grow him. She, a woman... gives a man his depth of spirituality. She leads him to that place. And a man does something different for a woman as well, too. But he needs her to grow so she can actually give that to him so he can then give that back to her.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying? So there's this cyclical thing that needs to be happening here.
Yeah.
For a man not to want a woman to grow or not to want a woman to tap in to her, that masculine, that yang side... there's something really, off. Yeah. There's something off in him where he's not really operating from a balanced or whole or complete space himself.
Right.
It's really what I believe is like he's operating from like an old archetype. Like say for example 1950s.
Yeah.
Right. 1950s. You got the let's say like
the white picket fence. Yeah. The
Caucasian family. Mm-hmm. He goes to work and he's, you know, got his hair and everything.
She stays at home.
She's cooking and the kids and everything like that. Right.
Betty Crocker with the apron.
That's that sort of. I believe that's the snake skin. That's being shed. That's that old snakeskin that's coming off that needs to go.
I'm going to interrupt you just for a second. Just because I want to make sure that.
Go ahead.
It doesn't make that aspect wrong. Because stay-at-home moms and keeping that dynamic is still, like, it doesn't, we're not judging what's right and what's wrong.
I think that mentality only doesn't work when that mentality shows up with an empowered woman. You see what I'm saying? That's where it's missing.
That's just what a distinction I wanted to make.
We got two different archetypes happening. So,
yes.
Like next subject, we have like an old, let's say 1950s archetype mentality of the man who's thinking, oh, I'm intimidated by this woman. He's more like a traditional, outdated, I feel, mindset. He needs an update in his thinking software. And a woman in this particular case who's learning to tap into her power, her intuition, her masculinity inside of her, she's actually growing and evolving. Listen, folks, you know this. I'm not saying that new. She's not saying that new. Mm-hmm. We're in a constant state of evolution. We as humans are not in the most evolved state of consciousness or the most evolved state that human beings have been in the human being existence. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Look, I am, like, compared to how I've been in other lifetimes, I'm a Neanderthal, you know what I'm saying? I'm not, like, at the bottom of the total pole where I used to be, but I've been, like, I just know, look, I know I'm getting kind of deep here. Maybe you don't believe in reincarnation, I do and everything, but I know that I've been, in Egypt and stuff like that, where I've been much more evolved.
Yeah.
You know, my chakras lit up, third eye, everything open, you know what I'm saying? Everything just on point. And
now we're
getting back to, you know, realizing who we are, who we've come from, what we're truly capable of, our true power, you know what I'm saying? Who we are to one another, that respect, honor.
And who we are within, the balance within.
Well, first we have to have that balance of acknowledging who we are. Because, look, if I don't, oh my God. This gets so deep. Look, men that, and this is women too, but I was talking about men the other day. Men that rape or men that hit a girl or hit women, men that hit men. There's something that is, there's something, they view themselves a particular way. Okay? They view themselves a particular way. There's a saying that I want you to remember right now, actually. And I came across this saying, and it just had me go off on this really just this thinking tangent. And the saying, when I heard it a couple weeks ago, it says, don't fall into the illusion of seeing yourself small. So that's in a sense like half of it. When we see ourselves small or as, in a sense, just a guy that grew up in L.A. or just a regular human or a guy that has a 9-to-5 job, we're seeing ourselves small. Or even a woman, just seeing ourselves.
Are you saying, for clarification, are you saying that the person that then is the physical abuser is seeing themselves as small, that internally, subconsciously, they see themselves as small?
When someone
to make other people feel small.
Well, in a sense, but when someone sees themselves small, they behave a certain way. When someone sees themselves as divine, or a celestial being, or someone that actually has balance and connected, but like a divine being, like you are you're a Buddha, you're a Jesus, you're a this, you're a that, like you're capable of some amazing things. Like you're just not this limited being right here.
Right.
If we think that we're limited, we're gonna behave in very limited and very low vibrational ways. If we understand the truth, which is how divine and where we come from, and that we're these amazing beings, and that we come into these finely tuned high high vibrational, highly conscious vehicles of consciousness, these bodies mm-hmm. that we are, you know, require amazing fuel and amazing, we give off amazing, we're creative beings that we are capable of, you know, creating so many, then we'll behave very differently.
Yeah.
So when we believe ourselves to be these divine beings, you speak differently, you behave differently,
you cherish others differently,
you treat others differently. Yes. When you don't think of yourself as this, when you just think maybe you fall into the illusion, because look, this is all an illusion here, as far as I'm concerned, this is an illusion, we're playing a game. When you fall into illusion of thinking that we're just a human,
right.
in a sense, just a human, just the physical part of being human,
right.
then we behave in a very, you know,
rudimentary,
survivalistic
mm-hmm.
way.
Mm-hmm.
And our behavior is that way. And that's mm-hmm. where we get, you know, when we have a society that tells us and just really creates the mood, kind of like set
yeah.
design, you know, it kind of creates the mood of drama and, you know, because I look on billboards and TV all the time. What do I see? I see sex, superficial content, like when you talk about mainstream, what's being blasted out there, mainstream to most people.
Well, everything's set up to put us in these archetypes or set up to put us in our own thought process that's limited. We're not set up. We're not having an outside, like what's outside of us doesn't reflect an internal conversation of being an expanded being.
Right. Right.
It doesn't.
You gotta
search for those types of... Yeah, you have to search for those people and search for all those different things. What do we got? Comments? What up, sister?
What's up, sister?
We are an infinite energy in a finite human body experience. Exactly.
Boom.
That's why Lama sits there.
You know, this... I mean, that... But we have to know that, and like what you just said, we are an infinite source... In a finite, you know, time and mm-hmm. time and space, right here and now.
That God, that collective consciousness, is the infinite.
We gotta get to the, back to the place where that's a given, where we know that it's like, oh yeah, of course I am, of course I'm connected, of course I'm this
mm-hmm.
infinite, of course, yeah, and where it's not even a thought, where it's not even like we don't even need to talk
that's
about
where
it. So that's where it's
the
like boom.
Respect comes in though. That's where honor and respecting, and then creating rather than just being in this limited perception of just archetypes, you know, even just the simple archetype of, you know, what's the new popular, like the king and the queen, like
mm-hmm.
those are still archetypes that are still limited, like that's a finite.
I mean, if you say like divine king and divine queen,
okay.
that's different.
That okay,
because that
well,
takes it off of this planet.
That's just
that,
adding
that,
a
that,
really nice adjective.
Well, it is, but like for me at least, when you add different things like that, that takes it out of the physical realm. That
That's
puts
what
it
I'm
into
trying
the ethereal.
To say.
That's
yes.
what I'm saying.
And so we're talking about creating or seeing and offering up the expanded, I guess, kind of perception that has more of a conversation of respect and honor and getting, I can say getting back to respect and honor, but like, I don't know when that actually was. So.
Well, it's been a few thousands of years ago, back when I
can't remember at least a couple of my lifetimes.
I wasn't taught, and I was raised in this world too.
Right.
I didn't know how to really like revere the feminine energy.
Correct.
How to respect it, how to honor it. Like I had to like search, and like my soul knows.
Well, and women,
but
the same
like
way,
I had
women.
To like search and you know and, like try to figure that this stuff
yeah.
out again. You know, but we're getting.
You're not taught
we're,
this
we're,
in school.
No,
we're educated on
I this. Think that we're and the, look. This is why we're actually doing this video.
Yeah.
We're not doing this video. Like we have this conversation all the time.
All
anyway.
The time.
All
like,
the time, like on your balcony, and you're like, you should be recording this. Like we would have like hours and hours of footage, but like we talk about it because one, we're passionate about it. Two, it's important.
Yeah.
Three, it'll make a difference in this entire planet. You know, I mean, there's endless reasons, but like this, it's so important for us
but
to remember
it,
who we are.
And when is it going to mean enough for that? Like that's been my biggest question. When is it going to mean enough for people to like remember that and want to treat each
when
other
the,
like
it's
that.
Like it's like when the pain gets bad enough, then it's like okay, well, it's
got to
be more.
I don't know. People are
this.
Addicted to pain. That's what I'm like. That's a whole other. This is a deeper topic. But point is,
what is your point?
Point is, we're opening the conversation to have a deeper awareness on greater respect of the feminine, honor of the masculine for both men and women.
Like what I've been coming up with.
What have you been coming up with?
When I've been experiencing, you know, is a such a profound, and when I say profound, I mean really profound admiration, respect, reverence, even worship of the feminine. Listen, women, y'all birthed everybody on this planet. Over 7 billion people. That's pretty amazing. That needs to be honored and revered and worshiped that y'all actually birthed this whole planet. That alone is amazing. And it's like, what makes me angry...
Not alone.
What makes me angry is that the whole vibe of this planet has been like set in a sense to that... Almost like that doesn't matter, and that a woman right. doesn't know how to do what she does naturally, which is right. be a woman. Like she, like the doctors know how to have a baby better than a woman now. These men doctors, that's ridiculous. Women innately know how to. Women have been having babies for I don't know, thousands and thousands and thousands of years before.
A couple more than that.
And, right, thousands and thousands and thousands of years, and you know these doctors have only been around for 50, 60 years, and you know what I'm saying, doing these sorts of, our doctors at least, you know, but before that, women have been revered for their intuition and for their grace and for their feminine power, and in other countries, they're really respected for that. They're respected, they're honored, you know?
Not every country, most countries
well,
are,
not every,
you know,
not
no, no,
every
no,
country.
But
yeah,
I mean,
exactly.
it's still a global thing, like, you know,
it
there's
is,
women
yeah.
who are, you know, you have to cover yourself up, like, that's shameful. There's so much shame around, like...
Having female babies is a bad thing in some countries, it's supposed better
true.
To have a boy baby, which is
the
obviously
The feminine
ridiculous.
Energy, and this goes, yes, for women tapping more into our feminine in the competitive masculine world, right? But it's also men then embracing more of the feminine within them without losing that, like, masculine edge.
Right.
And then women being able to embrace, like, that masculine kind of, like, backbone within them,
right.
you know, that's like, okay, like, we can, like, it's not about needing a man anymore. Women don't need men. Technically, to birth the child, even if we were going to go down that road, like we need a good portion of
well,
you.
Well, I got a little different opinion
no,
on that.
No, but what I'm saying, let me finish real quick.
Finish. I still got a different opinion.
And I don't. I hope so.
Finish.
And at the same time, you made me lose my train.
I know.
Of
I know. I'm gonna jump in there too. I think men and women do need each other. I think. For basic...
Need in a different way. Want is what I was going to say. That was the point.
Well,
want versus need. Need comes from fear.
Okay, break it down. I'm
if
listening.
You need
if you got
something
your
and you're like, I don't have that part of me, then I need this thing to then complete me. I need this thing to take care of me. I need to, you know, the woman, the archetype of like the damsel in distress and she needs the hero mm-hmm. to save her and blah, blah, blah. And it's like women are now coming stronger up into themselves that they're not needing a man to do that. Because then what I believe wanting a man in life, right, is actually stronger because it's not coming from fear.
Yeah.
It's like, yo, I've got this. I can
yeah,
handle
yeah.
this. So if you're in my space, I want you here.
So what we're talking about right now is, you know, she, in a sense, is
it
the yin.
To.
She is the yin. I am the yang.
You might be a little yin,
and we create a yin yang perfect,
yes.
you know, synergy together, the masculine, the feminine. But within each of our halves, I got yin and yang as well too,
and
she's
yin
got
and
yin
and
yang as well
mm-hmm.
too. And before I try to get, like, say for example, if even this relationship, even if it's just friendship, or if it's
yeah.
another relationship, if it's romantic, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Before I get into this relationship between me and my sister is going to work best if my
right.
dynamic is set here. If my yin and yang, if I'm balanced, if I'm complete within myself,
yes.
if I'm not looking for someone else to complete me or make me happy, now she
yes.
can add to my happiness, she can add, like, be some icing on my cake or whatever as a friend or whatever, but, like, I'm the cake. Like, this is the cake right here, man. You know what I'm saying? I don't need nobody to, like, give me no eggs. You know, I'm baking myself. Well, you can be the Betty Crocker, man. I'm going to be the James Brown for a little bit.
Oh! What's the matter with being your own Betty Crocker?
This is a man's world.
You got a problem
world,
with a man being
nothing,
a Betty Crocker? Don't contradict what we're talking about. Okay, we have a comment. Soul's Journey. Wait, hang on.
Yeah, go ahead and do.
What's my girl saying? Let's see. Suffering.
Let's take some questions.
Where are we at? We're at 7:30. Okay, so
don't
Erica.
Look at yours.
Erica says, suffering is the foundation to the human experience. In order for our energy body to evolve into the next vibrational journey, how does one choose to really change the perception of the world without, hang on, is this going to let me open it? Because sometimes that doesn't do that.
The scroll here, hold on.
Yeah, but see, it won't open the whole thing. Oh.
To the world without the experiences of the suffering that came before them.
Mm. Now, and the soul's journey is truly a miraculous concept. Exactly.
I think suffering is needed. You know, I think there's suffering that is needed. Falling down is necessary so you can get back up. But how much is what we're talking about? How much suffering do we need before we get back up? Do we need to keep getting dragged by the horse, behind the horse, for miles and miles and miles? Or just do we need like a couple hundred feet? You see what I'm saying? It's like, that's the difference, what I feel, actually. You know, I had an experience growing up where, you know, it's. I think that we're supposed to have dark experiences to learn a lesson.
For evolution,
yes. Suffering. But I don't believe we're supposed to stay in the dark forever. Go in the dark and distinguish that you're the light. Go in there to remember that you're the light. You have to go to the dark.
Show them that you're the light.
But you have to go to the dark to see your own light, to be able to exercise your soul, to be able to shine your light.
Yeah.
You can't shine your light in the midst of creation itself or you know, God or whatever you believe, because that's all light. It's like you have no, it's too bright. It's like, so what does a soul want to do? It's like, want to go in the darkness, go in dark experiences. That's where the suffering's at. And then there you can actually say, hey, I'm more than this. I am the light. I am that. And then you can distinguish. And then you can move back and then grow back to the light, which is what I feel exactly what you're saying. Thank you for that comment right there.
Then not getting addicted to
the suffering. Exactly.
Because that can, you can get addicted to your pain body. You can get addicted to like that. You release adrenaline out of that. And so if you get caught up in that loop, so it's like, go for an experience. You know, you go to Disneyland for the lesson.
Yeah.
But
where
then
did
take
you learn?
The lesson, but then stop the whatever repeated action that continues your suffering.
Like say for example, one of my
but
mentors.
That takes like, that's train, that's, what's the right word? Like dedication to self to then stop that. Because once you're addicted to it, it's like riding the same ride at Disneyland, like every day, all day. Like you want to go to Disneyland like every once in a while.
Yeah, I mean you want to go in there and get the nuggets for it. Like what is the situation that happened? Why is this showing up? Why are we, you know, why is this happening? You know? So but yeah. So
let me see.
I know we had another question over here.
You guys are awesome.
Love that you're highlighting feminine strength, intuition, and creativity.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Who was that? Sherry?
My neighbor, yes.
What's Ren say?
Energetic qualities. I love you too. Dion, my man. I love you too. See, like, Dion, he's like my little bro in here and everything. He says, love you, big bro. That right there.
I call you brother. Yeah.
I know, but that's a man.
Calling you brother.
Calling me, he's saying love you. This is what we're talking about, which is a great thing. You know, being able to express your feelings,
love, exactly.
Being able to express love, that's being a balanced human being. Someone being a balanced masculine, being able to step into your masculine and being able to actually express it and have the space to express it. And, I mean, that takes courage to be able to do that. You see what I'm saying?
More love on that one.
I know what you're saying. Powerful, man. Let's see.
We have a question over there too.
If you got some questions, we're taking questions right now to our comments. So Juan is talking about, he said, in my case, for almost 2 decades of my life, I have had conflicts with having that male presence in my life, and even now I have moments where I cannot access that physical I'm not sure. I think it just kind of cut off. Maybe it was long. Bad visual. Okay. Also, you get that flack from about being strong too.
Okay. What did she say?
She says that she gets that flack from men all the time about being strong.
About her being strong. Yeah,
yeah.
It's a pain in the butt.
You know, here's a fine. I think there's a balance between that as well too. I think it's balanced for both.
100%.
You know, a man can't go around. I don't say he can't. I don't think it's balanced. I'll say if a man goes around blubbering and crying and expressing themselves all the time, like, I feel this, I feel like you this, I feel like this, I feel like this.
But if a woman did that too, then it was.
I think it's too much for a woman as well too. Yeah. Exactly. It's like blah 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 blah. You know what I'm saying? But at the same time, I think it's a woman. I don't think a woman. And you and I were just talking about this. I don't think a woman. I think she has to use her intuition on when to access her masculine strength and when not to.
And
being sensitive enough to know when is this applicable right now, being sensitive to who we're interacting with, being sensitive enough to the environment. Is it appropriate right now?
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes it's like, okay, is it gonna be received, or is it gonna be received well, or is it gonna cause more damage than something else? You know? Not that we should be worried so much about what other people think.
Yeah.
It's not that, but it's more about it's cause and effect.
Right.
Sometimes it's better just like, hey, I'm just not going to say anything right now.
Right.
You know?
Well, and weren't we saying that too with, and Ron had a question, I want to scroll up before.
Yeah, go ahead.
Weren't we saying that too about, you know, then even a man tapping into his intuition, this is where it's like tapping into the feminine aspect, just intuition being more feminine, right? Tapping into the feminine intuition within himself as to then when to approach a woman.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if we're not tapping into our intuition, then it's not fully conscious behavior.
Right.
I'll say it that way. That's my personal...
I think it would have been going back years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, but the certain level of consciousness that's happening in this world, like this world is waking up.
Mm-hmm.
People are waking up. The level,
and people want more.
The quality of consciousness is better. It's higher.
Yeah.
It's higher vibration.
Yeah.
So if we're not consciously evolving ourselves and actually accessing that intuition within ourselves to be able to perceive more and to be able to do more,
mm-hmm.
Et cetera, then we're really not really mm-hmm. cutting ourselves off short. We're not actually accessing
the
truth.
The GPS. We have a GPS
yeah.
we're not even using.
That way, yeah. That was for the women. Now we had this cool saying like guys that are not for men.
Not honoring
all aspects of the feminine is like having a GPS system that you don't
that
use.
You don't use.
And it's like, you can get there, but you can get there a lot faster if you use a GPS. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, you know, a female is our ally, is our,
right.
you know, compadre. I you know, this leads us into something we didn't cover actually
right.
just yet. I think that theirs is very, very important as well. The old archetype of a woman was very limited. And if we go back like to the 1950s again, if we use that as an example, she was very limited. Like, she wasn't capable of like doing much necessarily, you know,
mm-hmm.
or in society, she wasn't
mm-hmm.
viewed as capable. And even she viewed herself, she, you know, accepted herself in a subservient role.
Right.
And she was, you know, viewed maybe in three or four different ways. She's a mother, she's a wife, she can cook, and she, you know, this and that. But she wasn't, that's gone.
Right.
You know, the way a woman is viewed now, she has way more than three or four or five aspects to her. And, you know, a woman has, you know, I have no idea how many aspects a woman has, but she has, you know,
a couple more than
two or three. You know, she has 20 or 30. There's so many different aspects of a woman that need to be appreciated and acknowledged, and a man needs to know how to show up to properly address those other aspects, because a lot of women are just like they're evolving. They're these new aspects are kind of waking up.
Well,
you know,
and then,
from this slumber, this sleep, and she's using these new aspects for the first
mm-hmm.
time in her life that have never been used and accepted mm-hmm. by people in her life or the world,
mm-hmm.
but But these women, a lot of women are accepting it. You know, they're doing things like whether they're doing sports or they're lifting weights, they're accepting this. They're accepting. They're getting in touch with this dynamic power. They're doing all these things. They're being moms. They're being creatives. They're being professionals. They're being, you know, artists. They're being all these different aspects.
Ultimate multitasker.
Amazing. Yeah.
And at the same time, I think, you know, honoring the masculine too at the same time, because the more that then men can tap into that within them, then they get to use more of those aspects.
Yeah.
And honoring the masculine, where it's like, okay, if a woman is honored for that and, like, you know, using the GPS, right? And using her as a GPS. and respecting that and acknowledging that. Like, women love acknowledgement, yeah. Right? And then at the same time, then the man gets to create this, like, space for her at the same time. And it's not, or not that it's not, it's like she, the woman appreciates that in the man at the same time. A man that can really create that space that then is honoring of that. Like, and I'm going to use the word need, a woman then in the relationship dynamic does need that. She needs the man to be like, okay, like, you might be the GPS, but baby, like, I'm the gas pedal. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
And just because then that's not an aspect that that's not as much of a strength in women, so it becomes this partnership.
That's
it
really well
this,
put.
Like,
that's really well put. Like, a woman is, like, you know, more looked at as a GPS, like knowing where to go,
the
guidance,
all-seeing.
The all-seeing, yeah. And the guy is like a gas pedal.
Right.
It's like the go.
Yeah.
And let's
and
go
fast.
And go fast. And let's, you know, get over this and get through this, and I'll get you
there. Get us there.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, you know, you can't just have one or the other. Obviously, if you just hit the gas pedal and don't worry about where you're going, you can imagine what's going to happen. If you just sit behind and don't hit the gas pedal and be like, okay, we can do this, we can do this, and this, you ain't going to never go nowhere.
And I find that in relationships, because within ourselves, it's easy to kind of like, well, easier to come up with, like, okay, what side's going to do what? You know, okay, my masculine is going to, like, drive right now, right? And I'm going to use my feminine intuition to, like, see where I'm going.
Yeah.
Like, we are in a relationship with ourselves, right? But then it becomes a little bit more difficult where then you become in relationship with other people or other men or then men with women, right? And then it's, like, allowing the space for who's going to take on what roles. Because if you're not allowing the space for who's going to take on what roles, and then the man's trying to do everything, and then the woman doesn't get to be acknowledged or, like, whatever, right? Then it creates this misharmony. You're not using all of the gears of the car. You're not using everything that's possible.
Yeah.
And then you just stall out.
So, like, the basic point of this episode, what we're going over is that...
archetypes.
Yeah, there's new dynamics showing up that a lot of you are familiar with, but, like, we are really, you know, just, like, passionate and really vested in bringing this topic so everybody can talk about it. So it can be not just something that, like, me and her talk about, but, like, people are starting to invest in one another, because it's really important that we respect one another.
Mm.
I mean, it's so important that we heal this dynamic between
the masculine and the feminine.
Because it's been damaged. And look, there's so much damage being done to our ladies, but then also at the same time to our boys. They've been damaged young because something's been, you know, misaligned and hurt within them to where they actually think that it's okay to either put their hands on a woman or put their sexual organs in a woman. Like, it's okay to go and actually use force to do that. Something has been, you know, kinked out of alignment.
Right.
I'm viewing myself a certain way, and I'm viewing you a certain way, and there's a disassociation.
It's the trophy concept.
There's not a connection here.
Right.
To what's happening over here. You know, there's an actual thinking that I'm separate from everything. I'm separate, and there's a thinking that if I actually do something, there's not going to be an effect. If I cause a cause, it's not going to be an effect. Oh, yes, there is.
Right.
There's going to be an effect.
And I think we also say this about women at the same time. Because there's a lot of men that I speak to that it's like both, and this was even in the survey as well that I did, it's like, both for, well, somebody said it as a joke, they were like, this is going to be bad, for every asshole, there's like a bitch that like messed them up, right? For every bitch, there's an asshole that like messed them up. And so either way, like that was, I forget who said that, but it's like everybody's been hurt and everybody's been wounded. And when I did the survey, I thought it was fascinating to find that men had the same heartbreaking experiences,
right, yeah,
by women.
Yeah.
And then women having, like, writing almost verbatim, it would look like, it looked like the same piece of paper,
yeah,
almost, of like, women have been just as brutal and treating men and not honoring and not respecting.
Yeah.
And so it's, we're just wanting to open up the conversation to just really bring in some more serious, like, love and respect and appreciation, because we are divine, because we're bigger than just this skin, because we're more than just this mind and what we're here doing on this planet, and really being able to create that connection. We have so many different things that are separating our connection. You know, doing a Facebook Live is great that we get to now, like, I guess, kind of connect with more people around the world, and yet at the same time, we have less and less physical connection. It's faster, it's less, there's not as much attention spanned, and so there's not, I feel like in order to really respect something, you got to give attention to it. You got to really, like, care and give, like, you got to want to look in to somebody. You got to want to get to know somebody, and I feel like there's less and less of that happening because there's the next best thing happening, or next quick.
And just like real fast on that, I'm not going to speak too much on that, but this, you know, when you're at Christmas time, you go down, you're so excited because you got Christmas gifts, mm-hmm, you know, and you want to open up your gift, and you get the gifts, and then it's the new toy, it's the remote control car, it's the doll, or it's the, mm-hmm, puppy or whatever. And then after, that's what Zen asked you. And then after, you know, a couple of weeks, you know, the excitement kind of wears down.
Right.
You know, and then it becomes like one of your toys.
You hit a plateau.
And toys, and it becomes, mm-hmm, one of your tools. Well, listen, that's what technology is.
Right.
Technology has been our new Christmas present. And we're so excited about it and everything. And we're like, we're still playing with it. We can't get off our phones. And we're like swiping, and it's like,
oh my God,
got this new
constant
thing,
dopamine release.
got this new thing
but there's always something new happening
on it. It's just, right,
yeah,
but it's just a new thing. It's just a new thing and it's going to level and play out to where it's like, okay, we understand what this new technology thing is,
right,
you know, for us, and we know actually how to use it. We're using it as a tool. It's
right.
Not something that, because right now it's something that excites us.
Right.
Like, this excites me, like,
right,
being able to connect with another
having,
human
like,
being.
Deeper,
like,
conversations.
Deeper conversations. Like, am I truly expressing myself?
Right.
Am I really expressing everything that I'm feeling right now?
Right.
Like, that
right.
excites me. You know, that's like some real soulful excitement.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it invigorates me, you know? And, you know, sometimes at night I get, I'm like, oh, I'm doing the thing, put my phone down, let me disconnect
go
from this thing.
Go to the beach.
And then I go to the beach and I connect, and now, like, today I was putting my hands in the sand,
mm-hmm,
and I connected like because I never have before. I'm just in a state of consciousness that I've never been in before. I'm, like, meditating at a good amount every day and stuff like that, and I have some time to myself. And being able to, you know, connect with,
you.
Not just, yeah, connect with,
mm-hmm,
me. At deeper levels, that excitement will never go away, ever. Technology is gonna do what it does, and it's cool and everything. We use it; it's a tool.
Right.
It's just a tool, but this amazing tool that's more than a tool, that's everything. Man, we need to get more and more excited about this and this.
Well, that's
right here.
When I feel, at least I'll say
how you feel.
How
do you feel?
I feel like the more that we want to get to know ourselves, the more that we put that time in to,
yeah,
taking that space and doing inner dive work, right? and feeling what you're feeling and thinking about whatever it is that you're thinking, just getting to know self, just getting to know you, right? Yeah. Then the more that we get to know ourselves, then ultimately the more that we're getting, like, we'll want to get to know somebody else at the same time.
Yeah.
And then the more, because, like, if we are such complex beings, then there's always a different layer to learn about ourselves. And if there's always a different layer to learn about ourselves, then ultimately there's always another layer to learn about somebody else. And if we look at it from that, like I like to bring in the almost like the child innocence of discovery, you know, especially when like interacting with people, where instead of judgment and instead of like, oh, you're this or you're not that or whatever it is, bringing out this like discovery, this like innocent child essence of like, wow, I'm enjoying getting to know you, and always looking at like a deeper layer, then ultimately we would never kind of get that, reach that plateau.
But we don't find that excitement of getting to know somebody, if we don't find that excitement of really that mm-hmm. childlike discovery,
yeah.
that has to be found here first.
Exactly. That's what I mean. You have to have the want and the childlike discovery within yourself first.
Yeah. And like know how to actually truly, genuinely see yourself and see your life and your situations around you mm-hmm. in that particular way. It's like almost bedtime for me.
And your, are we keeping you up?
It's like bedtime. I got to get up early. You know what I'm saying? Do my yoga in the morning. You know what I'm saying?
It is 8 o'clock. So
yeah,
let's jump on a couple questions because I remember.
Let's do a couple questions and wrap up.
Okay.
Bedtime.
Facebook says, okay, that's Facebook. Hang on. I want to go back because Ron said something. So hang on. Let me scroll through. Let's see. Okay, Ron says, can we declare the lessons we learned through our suffering? This is going back a little bit because we didn't exactly touch base, but can we declare the lessons we learned through our suffering to make the suffering end? What's the best solution? If we declare the lessons we learned through our suffering to make the suffering end, I think, so I'll answer my personal experience with that question, Ron, is it's twofold, because you can absolutely declare the lesson, right? Meaning you've addressed it, you've looked at all different sides, you've looked at your perspective and pulled yourself out of your own perception and looked at the other person's perspective. So you're getting a full rounded, kind of neutral third party observation. Got the lesson for whatever that situation is, but then the second step after receiving the lesson or perceiving the lesson, to me, is a change of action. Nothing really gets solidified until you create a different action around that. So if whatever the suffering is, you have to then want to release that and then change the behavior around that to stop the suffering.
Yeah. Work your butt off.
Work your butt off. What do we got over there?
Let's see.
We're answering questions, guys. So
and then we're
if
wrap up.
Yeah, and then we're gonna wrap up super quick. And we love that you.
Yeah, good. Nikisha said that as well. She said she had the conversation with her man yesterday
uh-huh.
when he thanked her for helping him to grow. Dope. Mm.
Acknowledge your man for that.
A man needs a woman to grow. Yes, and Tangi. Yes, indeed. Here's to all of us tapping into that intuitive space for all of us to grow and evolve. Yes, thank you. Here's to adult women as girls frequently. Is that the reason why men make reference to adult women as
women.
Girls? I'm not sure what that was in context
to. I don't know what
that means either. Okay, Tangi. Tangi's like, my motto used to be go big or go home. My new motto presently is play big or go home. Here's to all of us breaking through our stories,
nice.
The illusion in order to
yeah.
play big. Yeah.
Yes.
Brian
Love
Gaspel,
that.
What's up? Frankie Jordan, my little sis. Oh, good, baby girl. I'm glad you're getting benefit from this, too. I am as well, sister girl. My boy B, Brian, my man. He stole my girl Erin on Port Charles back in the day, but I still love you, brother.
Oh, that's Brian. Yeah,
Brian
he said,
Gaskell,
what's up,
yeah,
Brian? He
yeah.
sent me, I haven't seen him in years either.
Divine avatars, yeah. Divine teachers, divine avatars, yeah. Divine
mm-hmm.
beings, like, you know, the energy, who you are, like, where you come from. let's see, Juan, question. As a child being abused physically and verbally, I lost a vital connection with my father, and I noticed the common need for an inspiring or supporting male energy in my life. Is there a way...
Why does it get cut off? That sucks.
I don't know.
Is there a way...
I'm going to answer this afterwards anyway. Male and female energies are divinely intertwined, and whatever physical form possesses this energy must connect to heal outwardly and inwardly.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That's what we're talking about, because it's not about whether you're a man supporting a woman or a woman supporting a man. It's women supporting the balance of the masculine and feminine energy within herself, and then a man creating that balance of masculine and feminine within himself. And that's how we get to learn from each other, learning about the dynamics. Women learn about the dynamics of their masculine from men. You excited or your butt hurt? And women, you get the point. I love how you do something that I just totally lose my train of thought.
Okay, I guess it's my turn now. And then Yolanda said, it's hard to find it in others if they're in a rush. Yes. Well, yeah.
Wait, what? It's hard to find it in others if they're in a rush.
I'm not sure exactly what she's talking about, but I do know what she's talking about. Yeah, if others are in a rush, like if we're in a rush, we can't really be present. If others are in a rush, they can't be present.
You're projecting yourself into the future.
But we can't rely on others to be present for us to be present. So if others are in a rush, that's fine. But like, only thing we can work on is us being present right here, right now. And that will be the most magnetic thing to pull others into the present moment with you.
Agreed.
And then, you know, from that place, like this dude, I was in Whole Foods just like 3 days ago. And, you know, I make eye contact with people, but he ended up making eye contact with me. And when he walked by me and he was like, he really looked at me. He was like, he basically said, I see you in there. He was like, and I walked by him. I was like, this dude, I'm like, I had to go back and talk to him because he showed up for me.
Right.
Like he showed up. He was present. You know, he actually showed himself and he showed his soul and he basically said without words, he said, I see you in there, my brother. And he walked by me. But that's what he said. And I had to go back and like talk to him. And I went back and talked to him. I was like, as I was walking, I was like, you're funny. I was like, what's your name, man? How you doing? You know, because he showed up. You know, it's so different than someone.
But that's the recognizing in each other. That's like why after all those years, like when we passed each other and I was like, what up?
Yeah.
Like I saw you.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm like, okay, I get that.
Yeah, exactly.
And honestly, and that was the thing. Like if you guys didn't hear in the beginning or whatever, I didn't recognize you from...
She just said, I was a good looking brother over there. You know what I'm saying? I like that over there. I'll tell you what she was thinking.
Is your ego flying?
Yeah, that's my ego right there. Yeah. I know that's my ego. It's all good. But go ahead. What were you saying?
And my point is, thank you for interrupting me again. And my point is that I recognize you as a soul and your spirit, and I recognize your energy. And you have been one of like the brothers in my life that has like been so respectful and honoring of the feminine and my balance and just showing up of like, yo, I support. Like you're just always like, I support you regardless and endlessly and reminding me of even times like when I forget, you know, of like my own strength and my own like, you
that's
know,
right.
warrior divine,
that's
you know?
Right. That's right.
And that's
right.
why I appreciate right. having brothers like this in my life because he's amazing. Okay,
we
got one more.
We got one more.
Hang on. What would you say for people in same-sex relationships as they are essentially the same masculine or feminine energy?
As they hold essentially the same masculine or feminine.
I don't. Same-sex.
Well, it's same-sex. Like, it's man-man. That doesn't mean it's masculine-masculine. It could be masculine-feminine and man-man, or it could be female-female, but feminine-masculine. Mm-hmm. The bodies really don't really matter that much.
That didn't make sense.
Huh? I said it could be it could be a girl and a girl.
It made sense, yes.
Okay, good, because it made sense. You just like not following.
Did everybody else get
time.
That?
Yeah, they got it. Don't worry about them. They got it. Don't confuse it for everybody.
And
so, but that's why we say masculine, feminine. It's an energetic thing. It's not a
man,
she's man,
woman.
Man, woman thing.
Yeah.
It's an energetic thing. Like,
yeah.
You know, so that's, I hope that
answers
your
question. And there's still the dynamic within, like, yes, because even a man in a man's relationship, or two men in a relationship, they're going to have a balance of the masculine and feminine within themselves. Mm-hmm. And then how that shows up in their relationship dynamic is kind of ideal. I mean, I'm not in a man-to-man relationship, so I won't speak directly on that, but that's, we're talking energetics. And so that's,
Hi, Rachel. I gotta say bye, Rachel. We ended it right now, baby girl.
But you guys can watch the replay. And either way,
next week.
Yep, at 7. Because I think I did 7:30. Either way, it's gonna be 7 p.m. Yeah, Pacific Standard Time.
That's past my bedtime. It's 7:30.
Well, we're just keeping you up.
Get up in a little while.
We're just keeping this one awake.
Love y'all. Next week.
But he's so committed.
I don't know where we're going over next week, but it's going to be the next.
I think I'm pretty sure
evolution
we're going into
stage of whatever we've talked about today. Because today we wanted to like set like a foundation.
Yes.
And like get us all like on the same page. Yeah. And then we're going to start moving forward.
And feel free to send us your questions. You know, if you have either about this video, you know, or the next one, or anything like that. And I think the next one's going to be about like how to show up.
That's what Yolanda is saying too. It all boils down to the willingness to connect.
Yes,
the willingness to connect. And what does it take to connect?
Respect and
appreciation. Well, it's like it takes something in here to connect. Like there has to be work. There has to be work done. I feel a foundation set here to be able to authentically, deeply connect. Because if I'm just connecting, and if I'm connecting with my head, and I think I'm connecting, I'm just connecting here. I'm not really connected. You know what I'm saying? If I can actually do the work that it takes to connect as a whole, complete being, where I can look at you from my head, I can look at you from here, I can look at you energetically, I can look at, you know, and feel your aura.
Yeah.
I've done that work here, and then I have the courage to then share all of that to connect with you. That's one thing.
You can't see it in another if you don't see it within
yourself. If I haven't done the work here, if I only can connect here, I can only connect with this. I can't really authentically connect with everything. Connect with everything here first. And then have the courage to see, you have the power to see and connect with that else right there.
Being self-considerate.
Yeah.
You can't be considerate of other people, which is what I think really creates a connection. You can't be considerate and respectful to other people unless you're
first
considerate.
But it's like there needs to be an experience, like there has to be an experience of self-reverence.
Yes.
Self-reverence. Being amazed and respectful of yourself, honoring yourself. Like, why would you honor yourself? You know, when you look in the mirror, you know, I know we all have like some judgment sometimes, but like when you look in the mirror, like being able to honor your path, you've incarnated into this body to have, you know, your soul to have a human experience.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not the other way around. Like you're always this soul, this energy having this, you know, a human experience so you can evolve your soul, so you can grow your soul. This is Earth Gym with experiences as dumbbells.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? So use your experiences to grow. Use your experience to evolve yourself. Use your experiences and lessons and those people that are drama, the people that you don't like, which are the biggest dumbbells, but they provide the most value, you know what I'm saying? They give you the most weight to
lessons.
Push against. Those are your adversaries, your sparring partners, mm-hmm. they give you the lessons. Mm-hmm. Use them to grow yourself. Acknowledge them and thank them for them being playing the role as that dark energy in your life. You know what I'm saying?
It's a hard lesson.
It can be constantly challenging.
Got to do it.
So
honor them for that.
Next week, love you. Love your path.
Yes.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for engaging this conversation in both of us. Thank you for your heart. Thank you for your path. Keep relying on who you are.
Mm-hmm.
We're not who we think. We're not our thoughts. We're not our emotions. We got to know the truth about ourselves. Mm-hmm. We're this dynamic energy in these bodies.
Yes.
And you were born for a purpose.
And anything that you think that you are, know that you are more than that.
Yeah, that's right.
And then once you get there, anything that's what you think you are, then know you're more than that.
All right, y'all. Love you.
Mwah. Blessings. Bye, guys. See you next week.
Crossy David.